So we have been looking at differential algebraic systems or DAEs, and in my last class I gave some examples of semi-implicit DAEs. We also defined what is called as index of a DAE. So we have been looking at semi-implicit differential algebraic systems. So these can be written as dx by dt. So these equations are typically written by this coupled differential and algebraic system of equations. So this is zero vector, and x typically we call as differential variables and z we call as algebraic variables. So these are differential equations which have to satisfy certain algebraic constraints, and not all the variables appear with their derivatives. Okay, very common situation in chemical engineering, models in chemical engineering, unit operations. So you have algebraic constraints which typically define the phenomena which are occurring at a very fast time scale, whereas the differential equations would represent phenomena which are at a slow time scale. So in a distillation column, for example, this would be thermodynamic equilibrium, and this would represent dynamics of compositions, temperature on each tray. Okay, so we also looked at what is called as index of a semi-implicit DAE. So index is minimum number of times you have to differentiate this equation to get into minimum number of times you have to differentiate to get into a system of pure ordinary differential equations. Now remember, this is G here, and I'm writing another symbol here, S, which means that when you differentiate and get a new system of equations, this would be different. Okay, the new system will be some function of G, of course, but it will be different. Now we will look at a specific example and then understand this. Last time I talked about a mixing tank example. So this was a simple mixing tank. Okay, so this was the example that we looked at. Dc by dt is equal to C naught minus Ct by tau, and C of t is specified. That means beta t is a known specified function. Okay, so this is my G of z and g of z and x. Now note one thing here, the first equation contains both algebraic and differential variable. That means c, what is the differential variable here? C. Okay, algebraic variable by, you know, this is a semi implicit DAE, algebraic variable will be c naught t, right? Algebraic variable will be c naught t. Now the second equation does not contain the algebraic variable, and this can be a troublesome part. The second equation doesn't contain the algebraic variable, you can get into difficulties while solving, because CT, the algebraic constraint, is an implicit function of C naught T, and the first derivative here with respect to C naught T is equal to 0, so is not non-zero, so we have a problem. What is the problem? I'll just elaborate that. So this simple example actually turns out to be an index 2 system. Okay, let's go and see why this is a index 2 system. So what is gxz? Gxz corresponds to ct minus beta t, right? Now if I differentiate this, okay, if I differentiate this with respect to time, then I'll get dc by dt minus d beta by dt is equal to 0. Okay, but beta is a specified function. What is dc by dt? Dc by dt, if I substitute from here, I'll get c naught t minus ct by tau beta prime t is equal to 0. This is still an algebraic equation. We haven't got a differential equation yet, because I could substitute for dc by dt in terms of this. Okay, I could substitute, and so I still have an algebraic equation. I want a differential equation. Okay, to get a differential equation, I'll further differentiate this. Okay, so from this, what we get is c naught t is equal to tau beta prime t plus ct. If I just rearrange, c naught t is tau beta prime t plus ct, and then I can now differentiate this. I want another differential equation, which is now look at this equation. I finally have eliminated algebraic constraint. I have one differential equation in C, another equation, differential equation in C naught T. Okay, so now this is my S of xz. In fact, S of xz and t. Of time, because beta double prime comes. Okay, so this is my system with index 2. I had to differentiate twice to get to get a set of consistent differential equations, first order differential equations. So how will you use this index business? We'll come to that soon. Okay, now what is the problem? Why do we have to worry about why is it important to have index? Well, let's look at this particular problem. Well, when you have a high index system, there are two difficulties. One difficulty is that it's difficult to specify or it's tricky to specify, I would say, the initial condition. What you will notice is that C0T cannot be arbitrarily specified. For a pure differential equation, which is not coming from an algebraic differential equation, okay, you can specify initial condition arbitrarily and see evolution in, of course, the initial condition should make sense from the physics, but once you specify initial condition with that makes from sense from the physics, you have a unique solution as long as dou f by dou x is differentiable. And so we had talked about this continuity right in the beginning about the existence of a solution. Those things are not true here because of the algebraic constraint. Particularly for index, higher index systems, there is a problem. So there are two problems. Okay, now let's see where does the problem come from. Let's look at solving this particular set of equations using implicit Euler. So implicit Euler would mean that, you know, x n plus 1 is equal to f x n plus 1. I am just dropping for the sake of convenience the time argument. This is my implicit Euler would be this is my implicit Euler okay this is my I have to solve these two equations simultaneously, or rearranging this, you know, you can write 0 equal to so you have to solve these two equations simultaneously if it is implicit Euler. And if you are solving it using Newton-Raphson, for example, if you are solving it using Newton-Raphson, then you will get this matrix, Jacobian matrix. When you are trying to solve this using Newton's method, these two coupled algebraic nonlinear equations using Newton's method, you will get this matrix. This is Jacobian matrix that, you know, that you have to compute during each iterations. If you rearrange and then differentiate, you will get this. Okay. Now the trouble is with this. Dou g by dou z. Okay? If dou g by dou z, if this is equal to 0, okay, then you have trouble solving this problem when h goes to 0. For small h, okay, if this is 0, you can land up into trouble. Okay. So the nice thing about index one systems is that dou g by dou z is not equal to 0. Okay, we saw that flash example. In flash example, if you write algebraic constraints and if you differentiate, then you can show that dou g by dou z is not equal to 0, and then you can solve that problem simultaneously and get the solution without a difficulty. In this particular case, dou g by dou z is 0, because if you look at here, if you look here, this is my g of x z. Okay, the differential variable only appears in g of x z. Algebraic variable doesn't appear. So dou g by dou z is equal to 0. Okay, and then because this is a high index problem, okay, here this is my g of ct c0t, and obviously c0t doesn't appear here, so dou g by dou c0t is 0. Okay, and then that's why you have a problem here. Okay, now what is very, very important is that when you have a high index system, okay, this dou g by dou z should be when you have index 1 system, dou g by dou z is not equal to 0, you can solve it. For high index system, okay, if you want to solve it, it becomes very, very crucial then to be able to specify the initial condition properly. If you are not going to give the initial condition properly, your solutions can diverge. Okay, so I'll just continue with the same example. Okay, yeah, we have to use so the solution is, when you have high order system, high index system, okay, you should actually differentiate multiple times, go towards and then you solve simultaneously all the, I'll come to that. So but now you realize there's one more thing you should realize now. You should be able to find that thing using automatic differentiation. See, now for simple two variable, three variable thing, okay, I can find the index of the system by by hand differentiation, and I can say this is order second index 2 system, index 3 system, index 5 system. Maybe up to 5, 6 variables, 10 variables, you will do a lot of hand calculations and do it. If you have 1000 equations, okay, which is the case when you are simulating a chemical, dynamics of a chemical plant, section of a chemical plant, you have trouble, right? Because how will you decide the index? You should automate if you want. Just given a set of equations, you are not able to see what is the index. So you should have a procedure that automatically differentiates and calculates the index and then does appropriate initialization. Okay. So unless you do that, you are going to get into trouble. Okay. So I'll illustrate this and then give the solution, which is, he has very rightly guessed that you should use those differentiated equations to develop what is called as consistent initial condition. But just to show what can happen if the initial condition is not consistent, see, this is so C1 minus C0, I'm just using for this particular system, I'm just using the implicit Euler. Let's say my H is my This is the way I will use implicit Euler for this particular system, right? On the right hand side, at time 1, right, I am going from 0 to 1 at time 1, okay, and then other equation that I have is C1 is equal to beta 1, right? One here means t is equal to h. That's what we mean by 1. In our notation of time, we have taken t n is equal to n h. So we use n, right, to denote the time. It's a shorthand notation that we have. So this C0 is actually CH minus C0, okay? So these are the equations at the first iteration, the very first iteration, the other equations, okay? So after you rearrange this, you will get C01 is equal to okay. Now what happens for this equation to be consistent? See, what will happen with when h goes to 0? This beta 1 will actually tend to beta 0, because h is, you know, step from, you know, ahead of time 0. If h goes to 0, okay, what we require is that if h goes to 0, for this equation to be consistent, okay, we will require that beta 0 is equal to C0. We have to make sure when you start solving the equation that initial condition for C0 is given as beta 0. Okay. If you do not obey this constraint and start your integration, okay, integration can blow up. Okay, so giving a consistent initial condition is very, very important for a differential algebraic system. Extremely crucial. Okay, particularly the high index DAE systems. Okay, now what do you do to deal with, how do you deal with this problem for high index systems? How do you generate consistent initial condition for a high index system? No. See, beta 1 will tend to 0 as h tends to 0. As h tends to 0, okay, 1 will tend to 0, right? Because, see, what is the meaning of 1? See, this is actually t equal to h. As h tends to 0, so the initial value has to be given correctly. You cannot arbitrarily, see, in a normal differential equation, you can arbitrarily give C0 and it will work. Here, the constraint has to be obeyed, that C0 is equal to beta 0. If it is not obeyed, you get into difficulty. Okay. Generation of consistent initial condition for a differential algebraic system. Now this is a key thing, particularly for the high index systems. Okay. So what you do is you write this . So we define a variable y, or vector y, which is actually x and z stacked up, and then we translate this to some h of y, y prime t equal to 0. Okay, we translate this to y prime t equal to 0. Let p correspond to the index of DAE. Okay, then we differentiate this p times, which means so this is f y prime t equal to 0, then df by dt, which will obviously have y double prime equal to 0, and so on, up to, you differentiate this up to p times. Okay, and these are known as derivative array equations. Y p plus 1. P here means the order of the derivative. F prime, yeah, p plus 1. Sorry, p minus. P plus 1, not p minus 1. So these have up to p plus 1 derivatives of y. Okay. So these are called as derivative array equations, and to generate consistent initial conditions, we have to solve these equations simultaneously. Okay, so higher index system, why it becomes difficult to deal with is because you have to solve these equations together to come up with a consistent solution. In fact, if you solve it at time t equal to 0, you will get consistent initial condition. If you solve it any time in future at t equal to h, t equal to 2h, t equal to 3h, if you solve these equations together, you will get solution of the DAE. Okay, so if you know the index of the system, you can differentiate, stack the equations together, and then solve the stacked set of equations to come up with a consistent set of initial conditions, as well as you can solve them in time, and then you will get consistent solution of the DAE, high index DAE. Okay, to summarize, so I think what Vishal was, you had guessed right, that you have to solve them together. That is the solution. You have to solve these differentiated equations together to get a consistent initial condition. And of course, there is one more way. You can go on eliminating high order. You can go on eliminating high order derivatives, and finally, you can convert it into a form which is called as pure ODE plus state invariant. I'll just mention the form and then solve that. That is another way of doing it. But solving it at t equal to 0 will give you consistent initial condition. Okay, so derivative array equations you have to solve. You can see that why doing this automatically becomes difficult. So developing dynamic simulators, even though we have very very advanced computers, and even though we have lot of knowledge now about solving large scale equations, dynamical systems, it is still something which is a difficult task, because you have to do this business automatically. If you look at some of these commercial dynamic simulators, they don't ask you to specify what is the index of your differential algebraic equation. Obviously, when you are giving all kinds of constraints on the, you know, a heat transfer, mass transfer, thermodynamic equilibrium, and the dynamics associated with each of the units, you are not expected to know as a chemical engineer what is index, whether this is high index system or so you have to automatically internally find out what index it is, differentiate and create a stacked set of equations which you can solve. So generating consistent initial conditions, or use some other way of generating consistent initial conditions, generating consistent initial conditions or generating consistent solutions is a big task, is a difficult task. And if you make a mistake there, things can go wrong. The other approach is to reformulate. Okay. I think I'll again move there, because I want these equations. So the other approach is that, you know, other approach is that this derivative array equations then can be written in this form. This is a pure ODE, and this is a algebraic, these are algebraic constraints. Okay, so you can reduce by eliminating higher derivatives, you can go on eliminating higher derivatives. Now this business might be pretty difficult for a very large system of equations, but for some simple systems you can obviously do this by eliminating derivatives. We just now did this for the, you know, this mixing tank example, we eliminated higher derivatives and so on. So you can reformulate it like this and then solve it using a DAE solver, which is, so these are called as state invariants. These are called as state invariants, and then you try to solve this set of equations using a DAE solver. So with this, I want to just close this very very brief introduction to differential algebraic systems. My intention was to give you a flavor of what it is beyond, you know, just differential or just algebraic systems. In reality, you get always a mixture, and then solving it simultaneously is a difficult task. It's not that easy. Okay, so you need to develop expertise in solving these, and beyond a point, as I said, working with numerical methods and solving a problem becomes an art. It's not just the mathematics. It's you learn a lot of tricks of the trade, which everything is not written in a book, and cannot be written in a book. So for example, you know, when you start solving problems, you will learn that making variables dimensionless or scaling the variables, all the variables, helps improving the numerical accuracy or stability of the algorithms. If I have set of, let's take a distillation column, you know, you may have pressure, composition, temperature, appearing in one huge vector. Okay, pressure might be, you know, Newton per meter square, 10 to the power 5 something. Temperature is in, you know, Kelvins, 300, and concentration is in fractions, mole fractions. Then, you know, you have a trouble in numerically integrating such things, because the vector has imbalanced, you know, numerical values. So it helps to scale them on a similar scale and then work with the scaled variables. And these things are something which you have to learn by experience. Okay, these things, unless you are hit by a situation where everything is fine and you don't get a good solution, and you have to start thinking about now what to do. So that's where you start thinking, making defining dimensionless variables and all kinds of other tricks. So you just, it's not enough just to know the mathematical background. It's also important to know all these tricks, which you can learn only through experience. And as I keep saying in every of my instance of teaching this course, is that the good part is that it cannot be automated. You know, that's why we are in business. We keep getting jobs, you know, because you have to know some tricks, and that's where you can still, otherwise, you know, MATLAB or some software would be sufficient to solve all these problems. But even though you have very, very sophisticated solvers and softwares, and you still need chemical engineers who know numerical analysis to go and, you know, make fixes or make things work. That is because everything is still, you cannot automate it. You have to have some kind of human intervention, tweaking, or chemical engineers intervention to make the problems solvable. Okay, so let's have a quick look at what all things that we have done in this course. I would like to summarize this course by saying that it is not a course on computational or numerical methods, but it's a course on numerical analysis. We learn to do analysis here than just learning the methods. If the aim was just to make you learn methods, I could just go on writing recipes, and you know, you will not see the threads that connect them. And then it just becomes, you know, you memorize it and forget about it after some time. The reason for developing it as a analysis course is that you should remember, you should understand the fundamentals behind how a numerical recipe is concocted or is cooked or is developed. And then you should have this confidence of coming up with a new recipe if you are encountered with a new problem. Every problem will be different. Every problem would require different way of thinking, which will not be given in any of the numerical methods book, because real problems are very, very complex. You will have partial differential equations, differential equations, you will have algebraic equations all coming together. It could be partial differential equations in time and space, some algebraic equations, because you are lumping and saying that the spatial variation is not important. Okay, you know, and some algebraic equations because of some constitutive laws or thermodynamic equilibrium and so on. So you have a very complex system of equations which you have to solve. And solving, mathematically modeling and solving it is becoming very, very popular in industry, in academics, in research, everywhere. Because, you know, you can do an experiment without actually having to go to the you can do a virtual experiment. You can develop a model, play with it, understand how the model behaves. Hopefully the model at least represents in a respectable way the reality. And then if you learn something from the model, you know, when you go and design your experiments or design your equipment or do control of a system, you will have some a priori knowledge about how to go about doing it. Okay, that's what we hope when we into modeling. And so modeling is becoming very, very important tool. And then to develop models, you should be able to solve them and get some reasonable solutions which make sense. Now, most of the models that we encounter in chemical engineering cannot be, you know, the solutions for under different situations cannot be constructed analytically. Though we do study a lot of methods for analytical constructions of solutions, that is more to look at some idealized problems, simple situations. Okay, and of course, analytical solutions typically, which you can find for linear differential equations or linear partial differential equations, they give you a lot of insights. They help you understanding how things behave. They also help you in numerical analysis to benchmark your approximate solutions, to see whether approximate solutions are close to the true solutions. So there are different ways where you can use analytical solutions. And in some simple situations, analytical expressions can be generated. But even if the differential equations, partial differential equations are linear, not that every time you can generate analytical solutions. If the geometry is nice, okay, if you have cylindrical, you know, some thing which can be modeled as a cylinder, or it can be modeled as a perfect, you know, sphere or some cube, some nice geometry, then, you know, it's easy to solve those problems. But if you have some weird geometries, even if you are linear partial differential equations, you still have to go for numerical solutions. You cannot construct analytical solutions with some weird geometries. And the real problems are with weird geometries. Okay. So computational modeling or computational fluid dynamics, very, very important part nowadays in design of chemical systems. Now, the way we looked at it, the difference about this course and most of the other books which present a course on numerical methods for engineers is that we did not look at the methods based on the types of equations. We looked at methods from the viewpoint of tools. Okay. So the basic idea was that you have from a real system, you develop a mathematical model. This mathematical model typically would be, you know, algebraic equations or nonlinear algebraic equations or ODE or PDE, some kind of, you know, some kind of algebraic differential, partial differential, or their combinations, that kind of an equation. Typically, for the situation for which we would like to study this coupled set of differential, algebraic, partial differential equations cannot be solved analytically, unless very, very rare situations. Okay, so then we said that this, we have to transform the problem. So we spend a lot of time in understanding how to do problem transformation. So using approximation theory, you get a transformed computable form. This transformed computable form, in terms of its structure could be completely different from what you started with. You may have started with a partial differential equation. You might get, you know, algebraic equations, nonlinear algebraic equations. So what the transform problem could have completely different structure from a mathematical viewpoint than the original problem. Okay. What you end up solving is the transform problem typically and not the original problem, except for some very, very rare situations where analytical solutions can be constructed. Okay. Now then we said that to solve this transformed computable form, we only have you know, three or four tools. So one tool that we said is solving linear algebraic equations. So solving Ax equal to b, this is one tool. So this tool is used. Then the other equation or other tool which is very commonly used is solving nonlinear algebraic equations. So this is f of x equal to 0. Okay. Then the third tool is ODE IVP solver. So this is my third tool, and a fourth tool that we did not discuss would probably form part of an advanced course. Stochastic methods, okay, random sampling based methods. So we have three or four tools. It's like you know, it's like you are a doctor with, you only have three or four tablets with you, and you have to create a concoction. You have to create a recipe that will cure the patient. So you have to use some combination of these four tools, okay, and then what you get finally is approximate now is it sufficient that these four tools are with you? It is not. Okay. You also have to give inputs. If I think in terms of another input that goes is to solve a problem, you have to have some engineering insights from physics, chemistry, thermodynamics, whatever, because you have to give good initial conditions which make physical sense. Okay, so this component cannot be ignored. This is in fact the most vital component. It is not enough to have these four tools. You should know limits of these four tools. You should know about, you know, things like stiff differential equations. You should know about, you know, ill-conditioned problems and well-conditioned problems and condition number and eigenvalues and a relationship to convergence. And so all this analysis that we looked at should be there in the back of your mind when you're solving these problems. One of the focus of this course was analysis. We looked at how to do convergence analysis, how to use eigenvalues, particularly for solving linear algebraic equations iteratively. We could use, you know, the theory of behavior of difference equations, linear difference equations, and understand under what conditions the error will go to zero. Same, you know, theory of linear difference equations, qualitative behavior of linear difference equations based on analysis of eigenvalues. Also came to our help when we looked at, you know, different numerical solvers for ODE IVP. We looked at convergence of error, error between the true solution and approximate solution. When will it, and how do you choose integration step size? All that was, you know, analyzed using linear difference equations. Okay. So these are tools that help us. Well, for Newton's method, I just touched upon contraction mapping principle, though we couldn't go deep into it. So the idea was to give you flavor. Okay. It's not possible for this. This is a course that would prepare you for research. It's a course that is between your undergraduate course and an advanced course, a really advanced course. It's somewhere in middle. Okay. What we are doing is a course which is pitched in middle, where you know, you are introduced to various things like sparse matrices, sparse linear systems, then how you can speed up your calculations. Finally, we came to, you know, combine things like differential algebraic systems together and what are the complications. Okay. Now, things like solving partial differential equations, boundary value problems, all was dealt by approximation theory. Okay. If I go back and see what plays most crucial role in this is, how do you approximate? What are the tools for approximation? Taylor series approximation. Then collocations or interpolation polynomials, okay, or interpolating functions in general, and least squares polynomials or least square functions, least square approximations. Now, what is the origin? Origin comes from Weierstrass theorem, that any continuous function can be approximated with arbitrary accuracy using a polynomial function of a suitable order. Okay, so this one idea, which was discovered more than a century back, you know, it actually forms the seed of what has happened later on. Okay, entire structure actually critically depends upon this fundamental idea. So basically, we cannot really solve most of these problems exactly. We have a real system. There is a level of approximation when you develop a mathematical model, a lot of simplifications when you approximate reality using mathematical model. Okay. The mathematical model that you construct and the situations that you develop, again, you know, you cannot solve them exactly. You have to further approximate if you want to compute numerically. When you are computing them numerically, there are further difficulties. There is an error committed when you go from reality to the mathematical model, from mathematical model to the computable form, because typically we looked at these different spaces associated, and we said that the original problem is typically in the infinite dimensional space. You are approximating using a finite dimensional approximation. So you have limitations. So there is a lot of error committed when you approximate problems in infinite dimensions with problems in finite dimensions, because finite dimension problems are computable. Further, when you solve using computer has limitations. You cannot represent every number in the computer. It has a finite precision. Whatever bits you use, 128 or 256, you have a limitation at some point. And then that's where there are errors coming because of limitations of your computer. Okay. So what you actually want to do and what you finally see, there is a lot of difference. You have to use this part. This is the most crucial part, which I cannot teach in the class. This you have to develop by solving many problems, using all this theory, using the analysis which I taught you. Unless you start using it, you know, it's like you have been given tools. If you don't keep using them, then they don't remain sharp, you know, and then you will not understand why. So hopefully, you know, you understood why behind most of these methods, and then you'll be able to carry it with you. And so it was enjoyable teaching this course for your class, and I hope you have learned something. So with this, I would like to close this course on numeric analysis. Just remember this entire diagram and don't forget what is most important is your engineering insights and physics, which you cannot forget. All these are tools which will help only if you give correct initial guesses, only you make correct choices. There is no unique way of solving a problem. Okay? Each one will come up with a different recipe or a different concoction. You should have confidence to make a new bhelpuri when, or a new concoction, okay, when a new problem comes. That is important. That's what I wanted to learn through this course.